So this is the last lecture, which is about the relation between deep learning models and kernel methods. So this is what we call an open problem today, to understand what are the relations between these two approaches, which have been seen quite disconnected for a long time. And it turns out that kernel methods are now seen as a natural way to better understand what deep learning models are doing. And at the same time, I personally believe that there are many principles in deep learning models that are very useful, also for the kernel point of view. So I'm going to start with giving you a bit of motivation that we are going to see several principles that have appeared recently in the literature. And then we are going to discuss a few research questions. For example, the question of stability of the representation of deep learning models. And we're going to see applications to graphs representations, as well as applications to biological sequences, application of models that combine deep learning with kernel methods. So let's start by saying a few things about what are the important questions about deep learning theory. And then we'll see later that the kernel framework is a natural tool to address some of these questions. So there are several challenges. So today we have deep learning models that are very effective for many problems. And some of the challenges are that these models are often over-parameterized. They have millions of parameters, if not billions. And even more recently, there have been a trillion scale parameter models learned by Google for natural language processing. These models are also very expressive. They can approximate any function. And there have been many architectural choices that have been made to exploit the structure of the data. And these models with all of these features are still very easy to optimize with stochastic gradient descent, meaning that today the state-of-the-art approaches are using a stochastic optimization approach, and they are optimizing the training error up to zero error, and yet this model seems to generalize quite well. So this is surprising, and this understanding this fact is really one of the important questions that appear today in deep learning theory. So something which is useful if you want to do theory for machine learning is to view your machine learning model as functions in a some functional space. Why it is useful? Because then there is some hope that the structure of this functional space will be useful to derive properties of the models that you learn. What is also useful is that when you are able to design the right functional space, very often you have natural measures of complexity of your model. For example, you may have norms that can reduce the complexity of the model, norms that can be explicit, such that you can use it to regularize, or implicit, meaning that your favorite machine learning algorithm may also minimize a norm, even if you don't know exactly what this norm is. In both cases, the question is what is an appropriate functional space? And relatively recently, it's becoming clear that the kernel point of view gives one possible answer to this question. It's maybe not the only one, so I'm not going to claim that kernel methods is the only tool that to explain what deep learning models are doing, but this is one tool which is important to know. Let us now forget about deep learning theory and talk briefly about the success of these approaches and also about a few limitations, such that we can maybe get some intuitions about why kernels can be useful also in this context. So the success of deep learning, it will be easy for me to say that it is everywhere. It's not completely true. It's actually a great success for data which is structured, such as text, speech, images, videos, and today there are also successes for graph representations. And so this is a success when the data is structured, and also a success when you have enough data. So in the context of supervised learning, if I want to simply make a first link with what we have seen so far, remember that I like to motivate kernel methods from the supervised learning point of view, where we minimize an empirical risk and we have a regularization function, which is the RKHS norm. Now it turns out that deep neural networks also fall into this category. It's very popular to simply minimize an empirical risk on training data, where the yi are the labels, the xi are the input points. And what is specific to multilayer neural networks is that the space of functions that we are exploring is explicitly parameterized. The functions f of x, where x is here a vector, can be written as a succession of operations that are linear operations parameterized by these matrices a1 to ak, interleaved with nonlinear functions, pointwise nonlinear functions, for example, ReLU activation functions. So these linear operations, they are either unconstrained. In that case, we call that a sigma plus a a fully connected layer, or they may also share parameter and have a specific structure. For example, convolutions are adapted to the previous structured data I was mentioning. And the fact that if you are using convolutions, of course, you are going to reduce the number of parameters simply because imagine that you take an image which is not even that large. Take an image of size 1,000 times 1,000 pixels. It means it has 1 million pixels. If you are going to do a linear operation on this set of millions of pixels, then you have a matrix which is of size the number of neurons times 1 million. And let's say, for example, that you have a layer that even produces, 1,000 of neurons. It means you have a matrix that has already 1 billion of parameters. So that's a problem. So if you do convolutions, if you think about this, you reduce greatly the number of parameters. For example, these days, it's pretty common to have 3x3 convolutions, meaning if you take RGB images, it means that you are, for the first layer, you are taking as input, you are learning filters that are of size 3 times 3 times 3. And if you are learning, let's say, 1,000 of these filters, it gives you a small number of parameters. Of course, then you may have many layers. One layer takes as input the previous layer, meaning it's not operating on only 3 RGB channels. But at the end, the number of parameters can be reasonable. For example, there are popular networks today that have a few millions of parameters. And the billion scale networks are also appear in the literature, but there are also many models that can be trained with less parameters. Anyway, at the end, what you want to do is to find the optimal parameters, meaning finding the optimal entries of these matrices, which gives you a non-convex optimization problem. So if you listen to the classical machine learning literature, maybe you would believe that a non-convex problem is bad, but like I told you, when these models have many parameters, it turns out that you can still minimize pretty efficiently this risk using a stochastic optimization approach. What are the main features of convolutional neural networks? So it turns out I'm going to focus on these types of networks because they are very popular, they have been extremely successful. Even so, there exist other types of networks that are also successful. For example, recurrent neural networks, transformer architectures. Here, let us focus for a while on CNNs. So what can we say about CNNs? Well, first, we can say that they are not new. We can look at this picture from this paper by Lequin from the end of the 90s. Actually, the convolutional neural networks are even older than that. You know, that was already a review paper, I think. That was designed to classify digits, where we have, in fact, here it was a more generally than digits, it was for classifying handwritten characters. So we had a small input image here that is convolved with several features. Here only 6 features that gives, and we can, such that we can put the responses of these filters onto what we call feature maps here. And then you can do various types of operations. You can subsample these maps. You can even do this convolution operation again. You can also put nonlinear functions between the layers. And this gives you what we call a convolutional neural network. And the last layer here is fully connected and has as many outputs as the number of classes. So that's not a class about deep learning. I will mostly assume that you know what these types of models are doing and how they work. And hopefully you have even tried to train some of these networks yourself by using your favorite toolbox, such as TensorFlow, PyTorch, Keras, or whatever toolbox. Something of interest to us is that we often say that these convolutional architectures are also providing some invariance. Also, they may also provide some sort of stability to, you know, deformations of the input signal, that something that could explain why they produce good representations for images. That's one of the topics we are going to address. Something interesting for us as well is that they also model the local stationarity of images at several scales. So what does it mean? It means that if you consider a small neighborhood in this image, a small patch, you can see that if we look at the same location in the subsequent feature maps, there are also features that are present at these locations. They contain information about this neighborhood. And the local stationarity is telling us that if we have a specific pattern here, you will get a specific representation in the corresponding location of the feature map. But if we move this pattern to a different place, we're also moving the pattern in the feature maps. That's a bit hand wavy, but this is more or less what it means. And this is why, and this neighborhood, we often call that the receptive field of a specific neuron that is represented at a specific feature map. Okay. So, and by the way, that was an old one. So see here, I have a newer one, which is already starting to be old, but it's very successful as well. It's called the VGG network, or the network that was developed at Oxford that have several layers with 3x3 convolutions. Okay, this, you may have seen that also. Why did people start getting interested in convolutional neural networks around 2012? Simply because the computer vision community had organized for a few years already a challenge called ImageNet, which was the first large-scale benchmark in computer vision. So previously, before this challenge, you know, we had a data set that contains a few thousands of images, maybe 10 categories. And then there was a huge annotation effort that was made here to develop this data set with thousands of image categories. For the first time, we had lots of annotated data, 10 million of hand-labeled images. And the day we had this, these types of data, plus some additional computational power that were also getting accessible thanks to GPUs. Then after 2 years, basically the convolutional neural network started to win this challenge by a large margin. So these previous approaches, ImageNet in 2010 and 2011, were won by approaches that were using what are called handcrafted visual features, meaning representation of images that would use lots of manual design. Plus, in fact, concept related to kernel methods. Especially, I think, if I remember correctly, that in 2011, an approach that has won was using what is called the Fisher kernel. But then, these approaches that would require to learn several millions of parameters started to win. And but when I say by a large margin, it means that this error rate, which was around 26 here, went down to 16. And that was considered to be a lot in computer vision because the community was used to small gains a year after another. And here we had for the first time a large gain. But what is mostly surprising is that then these improvements, after improving the design of the networks, in particular making the architectures deeper, the error rate started to improve by a lot again, going from 16 to 3% in 2015. Then the success of CNNs also started to touch other fields. For example, for biological sequences, this is something which is pretty used. Even so, the gain may not be as large as in computer vision. We have here an example of a paper called an architecture called DeepBind that was also doing this sort of operations on biological sequences, meaning that you would represent your sequences as vectors, a sequence of vectors by using one hot encoding. and such that with this structure, you could define convolutions. And then you can apply a CNN on them and obtain good results if you have enough annotated data. Now, what are the current important problems to solve? So it turns out that even though there is a huge success for supervised learning, there are also many questions. There are questions about learning when you don't have lots of data. I would say that if I was giving this class 1 or 2 years ago, I would also say that there are issues about learning without lots of annotated data. But recently, there have been huge progress to learn without lots of labels. These approaches are called self-supervised learning. So I would say that the problem is about to be solved. But yet, this still requires lots of data, which is not annotated. More importantly, there are also issues about the stability of networks that we train using supervised learning. And I will comment a bit more on the next slides, because if you have never seen this, it's something which is pretty interesting. There are also questions about interpretability, but I don't want to discuss that during this lecture. So what about stability? I want to talk about this, what are called adversarial examples. So what are adversarial examples? They are, after you train a network, they are data points that have been corrupted by a very small perturbations, but this small perturbations is engineered such that the classification rate will drop by a lot. And we have observed that these deep neural networks are often very sensitive and unstable with respect to these perturbations. So there would be questions about, are these just numerical artifacts, or can they exist in the real life? Unfortunately, it's very likely that the answer is yes, that you can engineer signals that you can put in the real life that would break the classification accuracy of a specific classifier. So this is an example from a paper from 2016 where we have an input image, and then this input image is corrupted. Then you print the corrupted image on a sheet of paper, and when you take a device, here a smartphone, which has a classifier which has been trained to recognize these types of images. If we look at the clean image, we get something like, this is a washer with confidence 0.53, whatever confidence means here. But if we look at these images on the right, they are also corrupted, but we can't see it because the perturbation is very small. And this one here tells us this is a safe or a loudspeaker. So obviously this is wrong. It's easy for us to say that this is wrong, but that was an adversarial perturbations that exist in the real life because this image was printed on a sheet of paper. So that's something which is pretty intriguing, and obviously it's an interesting problem to understand why there is this possibility of adversarial examples and how we can correct these issues. So that's another example from this paper from 2013. These are images on the left, and after a small perturbations, which is amplified in the middle, we get the image on the right, which is classified as an ostrich. So what is an ostrich? This is what this is. So there are lots of very fun examples on the web. For example, here this tabby cat becomes guacamole. So that's pretty intriguing as well to me. But if we think about this, I believe all of this is also a question of regularization. How do we regularize these networks? Because when we train a deep neural network, let's say a CNN, to minimize an empirical risk, I was telling you as well that stochastic gradient descent is often used. It turns out that we are starting just to understand that stochastic gradient descent is actually implicitly regularizing the model. So meaning the choice of algorithm has an impact on the solution that you obtain. But there are also other heuristics that are used, such as dropout, weight decay, early stopping that may be sometimes necessary. But to get this robustness to adversarial perturbations, at least they are not sufficient. But in this class, we often motivate the need for regularization. We motivate this with a need for stability. Remember that we were often looking at this sort of quantities. Given two examples, x and x prime, if they are similar to each other, we want the prediction f of x to be close to f of x prime. So with our kernel methods, that was a framework which was pretty clean, not very flexible, but clean, and we could easily upper bound this quantity by the product of a distance between x and x prime in the RKHS, and also by the RKHS norm. So that's why we were using the RKHS norm to regularize. Now, what does it mean for images to be close to each other? That's an important question, and it's certainly not the basic literature on kernel methods who is going to answer this question. Now, what should be a good regularization function, omega? Well, do you have access to the RKHS norm? Yes or no? For deep neural networks, we know that SGD is maybe implicitly also minimizing a function like this, but which one? That we don't know. So let us start now the part about relations between deep learning and kernel methods. And if we look at the recent literature, there are a few concepts that appear and that provide part of the answer. So the first element, it's a technical point. By itself, it's not that related to a deep learning model. But this point is what we call dot product kernels. So what are dot product kernels? They are simply a nonlinear function which is applied to a linear product. So kappa here is a nonlinear function. I will tell you later what are the properties that we need for this to be a positive definite kernel. But sometimes we also have a variant where we have this normalization here. So I often call that a homogeneous dot product kernel, where we normalize the input here and we put back the norm outside of the nonlinear function. Why do I say that it is a homogeneous dot product kernel? Simply because the kernel mapping, meaning the mapping of your data point to the RKHS, becomes homogeneous if you do this operation. So now why can it be useful to be homogeneous? Think in terms of ReLU. ReLU of gamma x is equal to gamma times ReLU of x. And when you have many layers, it seems to be useful to have this homogeneity. If at some point you are going to stack several kernels or several kernel mappings, then getting the homogeneity can be useful, at least for theoretical purposes. And by the way, like I was saying, if you consider the kernel mapping, it will have this property that phi of gamma x will be equal to gamma times phi of x, okay, if we use this normalization. So don't worry if you see some normalization at some point. This is only a technical point. It's because of homogeneity. So this is the first concept, which will be useful for the next, let's say, 20 slides. There is another one, which is by itself not very interesting if we simply look at this from this formula, which is that, well, when we consider dot product kernel, we can easily do a composition of feature spaces. For example, if you have two kernels, K1 and K2, that have kernel mapping phi1 to some RKHS H1, and let us assume that the kernel K2 is operating on this RKHS H1 and is mapping the data to another RKHS H2, you can simply compose the two mappings, define a big phi of x as phi2 of phi1 of x. This defines a kernel which implicitly involves the composition of feature spaces. I will claim that it's not that useful to only see this point of view. It's becoming useful if you start exploiting the structure of the data. You will see later what I mean by that. Now, there are also two other concepts that have also recently appeared. This neural tangent kernel, which is a very hot topic these days because it's a very natural tool to understand the behavior of very over-parameterized deep neural networks that are learned by gradient descent. When I say very over-parameterized deep neural networks, it means that this neural tangent kernel is actually defined from a deep network whose number of neurons goes to infinity. So this is why I call that an asymptotic behavior. And it's interesting because it's one of the first work that actually characterize the solution of a deep neural network in this behavior when the network is initialized with random weights and then trained by gradient descent. So it's not the end of the story. It does not explain everything about deep neural networks, but I think it's a very interesting point of view. This other point of view, called the convolutional kernel network, or CKN, is something I developed myself, which was a way to construct an RKHS for convolutional neural networks, both with such that you can also see this convolutional neural networks from a functional point of view and characterize properties of the representations, obtain also some measures of complexities that are the RKHS norm. And what I think is also interesting is that it gives also an answer about what it means to do end-to-end learning with kernels, how to gain the flexibility that the traditional kernel methods are actually lacking. So I will present you that in more details later. So now let us simply come back to this idea about composing feature spaces. I was mentioning that it is something natural with dot product kernel, simply because if we consider dot product kernels on the sphere here, let's assume that things are normalized such that we don't have to do this homogeneization that was in the previous slide. Well, if you have a kernel K1 that is a dot product kernel that operates on the vectors X and X prime, that is defined as kappa 1 of X transpose X prime. If you simply add another nonlinearity on top of it called kappa 2, then you obtain, under some assumptions on kappa 2, you also obtain a positive definite kernel, which is also defined as kappa 2 of the inner product between phi 1 of X and phi 1 of X prime. By doing that, you're implicitly representing K of X, X prime as an inner product between this kernel mapping big phi of X, which is the composition of phi 2 and phi 1. So it's a natural way to put some hierarchy in the kernels. And there is this classical old result, which says that, actually you see that it's much older than machine learning. It's a result from the 40s. Which is about positive definite functions on the sphere, on the unit sphere. So let us consider indeed your input space to be the unit sphere of some Hilbert space H0. Let us define as above a new kernel K of XY as being kappa of this previous inner product between in H0. Then there is this result that tell us that this kernel is positive definite for all specific, for all choices of H0 and corresponding inner product, if and only if kappa is smooth and admits an expansion, a polynomial expansion with non-negative coefficients AI. So you see that there is one side of the proof which is in fact easy. If you choose a kappa of U to be of this form with non-negative coefficients, you have done, in fact, already similar exercises to prove that the corresponding inner product, the corresponding dot product kernel will be positive definite. What is more complicated is the if and only if, meaning if the kernel K is defined like this, and you want this to be positive definite for all possible choices of H0, proving that this imply this condition is actually much more difficult. For us, very often we simply need, in fact, this side of this theorem, the fact that if you choose kappa of U in this way, you get a dot product kernel which is positive definite. So here are examples of dot product kernels. Well, you may know the linear kernel, of course. The exponential kernel, where alpha here is a non-negative, you will see why do I put minus one here, is that if you define this dot product kernel on the sphere, meaning if Z and Z prime are normalized, In fact, this exponential kernel, you know it very well because it corresponds after tiny manipulations to the Gaussian kernel defined on the sphere. But there are also other cases. For example, this one is called the inverse polynomial kernel. This one is called the polynomial kernel of degree P. You have already seen that at some point in the slides, there was not this constant term here, C. It's actually, if you remove it, this is still a polynomial, the polynomial kernel, except that this is here the general formula. The arccosine kernel, let us not comment about this right now. I will come back to that because it plays a very important role in the literature about the relation between deep learning and kernel methods. And we have also other approaches that are often an expansion of basically a dot product kernel with specific coefficients. Okay, here is now the first relation that is in fact due to Neil in his PhD thesis from 1996, which was revisited successfully by Raimi and Resch in 2007. Remember, this is the paper about random Fourier features that we have seen in the previous lecture. So this should be still very fresh in your mind. Consider here the following kernel, which is an expectation where W is drawn according to some normal distribution. We have this activation function sigma and this linear operation W transpose X and W transpose Y that are done independently to the two inputs X and Y. You have seen something like that before. You have seen something very similar where we were doing random Fourier features, where sigma was this cosine function. But in fact, here, if we try to adopt a different interpretation, we can simply see that as what? As the represent as an inner product between a representation of X and a representation of Y. And these representations can be seen as one layer of a neural network with an infinite number of neurons and random weights. This is basically an inner product between two infinite dimensional vectors that contains the entries sigma of W transpose X. And you may choose sigma here to be ReLU, for example. So you see that, and this gives you a positive definite kernel. So here we have a link between this type of kernel and this infinite dimensional neural networks with random weights, which could claim that at this point, why should we care about neural networks with random weights? You will see that there will be an answer given by the neural tangent kernel that will be presented in the next, one or two slides. But anyway, what we see is that these types of kernel is related to this prediction functions f theta of x on the top, which are simply here a linear combination of this quantity sigma of wi transpose x. And we consider the asymptotic regime where m goes to infinity. So what does it mean? It means it's a linear function. It's a linear model after embedding the data x to this vector that contains all of the sigma of wi transpose x. And it's easy to see that the corresponding representation is just here when m goes to infinity, if these wi are randomly generated with random weights. And we choose here the Gaussian distribution. So one remark is that we have that, why do I claim it's very related to random Fourier features? Simply because we have seen that in the class for translation invariant kernels. But basically, translation invariant kernels and dot product kernels on the sphere are more or less the same thing. See, they are at least very related. And the concept of random Fourier features will also apply in that case. And a specific example where this relation we have a closed form representation for these types of kernels defines and as an expectation was given in this paper by Shu and Saul, which was one of the first papers that was analyzing or starting to analyze deep learning from a kernel point of view. So they consider there arc-cosine kernels. There was an example in the previous slide, but I'm going to give you the most general definition here, which is related to neural networks with ReLU activation functions. So consider this definition here, Kn of xy to be the arc-cosine kernel of degree n, which is defined as this constant 1 over pi times this norm to the exponent n, times this quantity gn of theta, which has a very weird shape. It's a trigonometric function that involves, so it may look a bit complicated here, so I'm not going to give you any proof of the result that is going to come next, so let us not focus that much about the particular shape. It is a function that involves the angle theta between x and y, defined as the arc cosine of x transpose y, where x and y are normalized. So that's why it's called the arc cosine kernel, because it's a kernel that depends explicitly on the angle between x and y. And to give you examples, to be a bit more concrete, if you take n equal to 0, it's simple. It's simply pi minus the arc cosine. If you choose n equal 1, you get this quantity that involves the sine and cosine of theta, and you get more complicated formulas when n gets larger. So this theorem is particularly interesting because it tells us that this kernel, and by the way, if you are not convinced that it's not a positive definite kernel, you can do that as an exercise. I think that you have all of the tools in hand to prove this, that these types of kernels are positive definite. But this theorem will simply also give us an alternate proof, which is that kn of xy, in fact, you can write it explicitly as the expectation that was given in the previous slide with a particular activation function sigma. So remember at the previous slide, I was motivating these random feature kernels to be this expectation over random weights over this inner product between these infinite representations given by one layer neural networks with an infinite number of neurons. This is in particular the case of arc-cosine kernels. So the activation function has a particular shape. It's u to the exponent n divided by square root of 2 times 1 plus the sine of u. So it may look a bit abstract, but look at what happens with n equal 1. When n equal 1, this quantity here becomes exactly the rectified linear unit activation function. And this is why this has raised lots of attention in the literature, because understanding ReLU network is something which is very important for at least theoreticians. That can also lead to some improvement in practice after the theory is clear. So this has become one of the fundamental tools to analyze ReLU networks. There are also variants where you can stack things together. You can also maybe put some convolutional structure, but the basic element is this integral representation of the arc-cosine kernel. Now, this I was telling you that, well, is it really exciting to study one-layer neural networks with random weights? Because after all, we can say that neural networks are about learning and random weights are not about learning. They are simply about representing data. So then this recent work about neural tangent kernel went a step further. You can consider again this setup, which is at this point one layer neural networks. It should be in fact two layers neural networks, meaning you have a linear model on top of a nonlinear representation given by one layer of a neural network. The initialization is random. All the parameters are drawn according to this normal distribution. Then there was this observation, which is very, very clear in this paper by Shiza and colleagues, that If you have lots of parameters, it's actually easy to change quite a lot the prediction function by moving a tiny bit the parameters. So you may think, say that this is a bad thing because it may lead to some instability. That's maybe true. But it's also a good thing in the following sense. It means that if theta stays close to the initialization theta zero, when the network is over-parameterized, meaning M is very large, then it means that this approximation, this linear approximation, becomes correct, meaning that f theta of x can be seen as f theta 0 of x plus the inner product between theta minus theta 0 and the gradient of f theta of x when you evaluate at theta 0. So now, what does it mean? It means that if you train your parameters with this that becomes a linear model in theta, it means in fact that you are doing nothing else than kernel ridge regression. Using what? Using the kernel which is induced by this part here. So what is the neural tangent kernel? It's simply defined as the limit when m goes to infinity. Of course, I'm hiding lots of assumptions. You want this limit to exist and so on. So let us assume it exists. The limit when m goes to infinity of the inner product between the gradient of the prediction function initialized at theta zero. So the gradient with respect to theta, not with respect to x, by the way. So this defines a neural tangent kernel. And if you are lucky enough to have a closed form representation for this neural tangent kernel, maybe you can start understanding what are the properties of the corresponding functional space and what are the properties of the data representation. So of course, at this point, we could conclude that the deep learning theory is done, because what we have understood a way to represent the solution of a deep learning model using kernel ridge regression. And we can now use the kernel machinery to derive properties of the learning problem, even also getting some ideas about how to regularize these models. In fact, it's not done yet for several reasons. One of them is that, well, in this slide at least, I present things only from a one-layer perspective. So now I must say that this concept, you can also derive it for multi-layer networks. You can derive it for convolutional neural networks, probably for recurrent neural networks. So that's not really an issue. The main issue is that it's not completely clear that this lazy training is enough to explain the empirical behavior of deep neural networks. Meaning that indeed, when you have lots of parameters, there are probably several layers in your networks that will have this behavior where the parameters are not going to move much. But we also empirically see, let's say when you train a convolutional neural network, that at least the first layers can be interpreted as learning some specific patterns in the data, which seems to mean that the parameters theta, in some layers at least, are very different from the initialization. So this means that the theory is not perfect, but I think this is a step which is quite significant still to understand the deep learning models, because there may be also layers for which this behavior is perfectly valid. And yes, I was saying what is also the relation with the dot product kernels, by the way. You can do that as an exercise. Consider this specific case here where the network has only two layers. Look at the objective function, compute your gradient with respect to the wi, compute the gradient with respect to vi. What you can show is that you obtain, again, a kernel that falls into the previous categories of kernels that admit an integral representation. And indeed, if you consider ReLU networks, so where sigma is equal to ReLU, you obtain a dot product kernel. And here, this is the derivative of ReLU, where the derivative exists. And W is also random, drawn according to this normal distribution. So you see that this is very related to arc cosine kernels. You know, if you take ReLU network, this first part is exactly the arc cosine kernel of degree one. So that's why this literature about NTK, arc cosine kernels, random Fourier features, the papers doing this theory are often using all of these keywords together. So I think that's all I'm going to say about neural tangent kernel. Hopefully you have simply enough background to understand the context and to get more precise results. You will, I encourage you to look at these papers, in particular by the one by Shiza et al. Now, it turns out that we are not done yet with dot product kernels, because I was basically saying that in the previous class about large-scale learning with random Fourier features, we have already one foot in the deep learning world because of this integral representations that could be interpreted as infinite, as neural networks with an infinite number of random neurons. But in the other part, which was about Nistrom, in fact, you already had also a foot in this deep learning world. So let us see why. So here is simply to refresh what the Nistrom method is doing. So you have what you are doing is simply replacing any point phi of x in the RKHS by its projection onto a finite dimensional subspace, which is parameterized by these anchor points z1 to zp for some anchor points z. And this was the illustration I used before in the class. So then let us now consider the dot product kernel, okay, where k of xy is equal to kappa of some inner product. Remember that the projection is solving the following optimization problem, so I will not insist on that because we have seen that already in the previous classes. But if we plug the closed form for solution of this projection, and we look, remember that when you do that, you obtain an approximate embedding psi of x, meaning that your kernel k can be approximated by an inner product between psi of x and psi of y. Using the dot product kernel, you obtain this embedding, which involves kappa of z transpose x. So kappa here is applied pointwise on this vector z transpose x. So how do we basically interpret kappa of z transpose x? It means linear operation applied to x followed by pointwise nonlinearity. You can perfectly see that as one layer of a neural network, except that the conditions on kappa are not the ones from the previous slides where kappa was this function sigma that was ReLU. Kappa here is a smooth function such that this kernel is positive definite. Anyway, it can have a shape like I'm going to show you, which is arbitrarily close to ReLU up to some error. And what I forgot to say is that then we have something which looks a bit different than what a classical neural network is doing, is this inverse square root of this kernel matrix evaluated between the anchor points. So it's kappa of z transpose x. It gives you a positive semi-definite matrix. You take the inverse square root of it. And you also make the assumptions that this is invertible to make this simpler. You can put these assumptions on z. Well, after you do that, this kappa of z transpose x multiplying by this can be seen as well as a linear operation if z is fixed. So in some way, if you fix the parameter z, this is simply the forward pass of linear operations, nonlinearity, and linear operation. Okay, nothing else than a neural network. So this is something which is not that well studied from, I think, from a theoretical point of view to make a link between deep learning and kernels. But I think this is something which is worth investigating. And why it's worth investigating? Because for me, what is interesting with this formula is that it also gives us a concept to improve deep learning models to do end-to-end learning. Because there was this question, and I remember that in some interactive sessions, some of you asked me, well, how do you design a kernel? What can we learn the kernel instead of designing it by hand? And I will say that you can make some architecture choices for the kernel. And then you can also, if you use Nistrom's embedding, you can then learn a subspace where you are going to project the data. Because this embedding psi, which is parameterized by z, it turns out that at least if this matrix here is non-singular, it's also something which is differentiable with respect to z. So that means that if you have a supervised learning problem, so here only for one layer, where you have a linear model on top of your Nistrom's embedding, if you consider this joint optimization problem with respect to W and Z, then you can use backpropagation to learn Z and your favorite ADAM or SGD plus momentum optimizer, and you can implement that on PyTorch or TensorFlow. At the end, what you do is that you are simply learning a subspace of the RKHS where you project the data. So the part that consists of designing the kernel can be seen as the part where you design the architecture of your neural network, and the part where you learn consists of learning the subspace. So you get this geometric interpretation. So that's for supervised learning, but let us assume that you want simply to use the classical Nistrom. Remember that with Nistrom, I was encouraging you to simply do a k-means to learn the anchor points. It's also something you can do here, right? You use your dot product kernel. You do Nistrom, you do k-means to learn the anchor points, and you obtain a classical kernel method, which is very related to this two-layer neural networks where, in fact, you adapt Z to the training data. For me, this is a link which is very interesting because there are not that many work in the literature where you are, in fact, learning the kernel in this specific sense. You have seen maybe one of the other lectures about multiple kernel learning, which was about learning combinations of kernels. Here, I'm doing something different. I'm actually learning a subspace of the RKHS where I project the data. And this gives you as much flexibility of a classical deep neural network. So what is the, and basically that was the case for a two-layer network, but you can do something similar in a convolutional manner. And that was the focus of this work about CKN called, which are called convolutional kernel networks. So what is the relation between deep learning and CKNs? One of the motivations was that I wanted to be able to linearize deep neural networks, meaning if I have a prediction function given by a deep neural network, f of x, which can be written as a collection of operations that are linear operations interleaved by nonlinearities, I wanted to be able to write this as an inner product between f, something which is your model, your prediction function, and phi of x, which is simply the data representation. By the way, linearizing the prediction function is something also you do with NTK. So in fact, there is a very strong link between NTK and CKN. They lead to almost the same RKHS. And this fact is in fact not well known in the literature. But anyway, the construction, the point of view were different from NTK, and it gives what we call convolutional kernel networks. So if I want to summarize with only two bullet points what CKNs are about, I will simply say that you consider a convolutional neural network architecture, and for the theory part, you are going simply to replace the ReLU of A times X, or A transpose X, depending on the notation, by a kernel mapping to some RKHS, where the kernel mapping phi is associated to a dot product kernel. And you are going to build a sequence of feature maps by simply replacing these explicit representations by this implicit mapping to an RKHS. So this gives you an abstract construction, and for the practical part, you replace the implicit kernel mapping by an explicit approximate embedding, which is given by Nistrom. So we come back to a representation which looks like this one, except that we have now this part here that gives us this interpretation in terms of subspace learning and in terms of projection. Then you can use either k-means to learn the anchor point Z, or you use backpropagation. So now, again, maybe a few comments about why do we care about the theory part? Why do we care about linearizing a deep neural network, meaning finding some Hilbert space H such that a prediction function can be written as an inner product between f and phi of x? We care about this because phi of x is the part which is related to the data representation, which is not, so that means it's related to the network architecture. If you choose a specific architecture, it means you are choosing a specific phi. And this is a representation which is independent of the training data. So it's the part of the design which does not depend on the training data. But then you can already answer interesting questions. Do you get something which is stable? Do you lose signal information, yes or not? And then after you consider your predictive model F. So this is the part that you train on the data. So this is the part which depends on the training data. The question is, can we control its stability? Can you use this classical inequality we have used already many times, meaning that you are using, if you can write this as an inner product, you can use Cauchy-Schwarz inequality and decouple this part into something that depends only on the distance between x and x prime, and a part which depends on the training data. And can you use f here as a regularization function? So that was part, in fact, of my research during the last few years, and we had quite a successful answer to these questions. So to conclude this part about, I will say a last thing about convolutional kernel networks. I will give you the explicit construction of the RKHS. So given an initial signal, how do we construct the RKHS? So we can do that for discrete signals, but to study questions about the stability of the signal representation, we are going to do this here for continuous signals. So it may look a bit more complicated, but it's actually not that complicated. So what is a continuous signal for us? It's simply a function in L2 that goes from omega, where omega is a set of coordinates, to a Hilbert space H0. So x0 is what we call the continuous signal. So omega can be simply rd, where d is equal to 2 for images. It's a system of coordinates. And x0 of u is now a point in h0. And if you take RGB images, you may simply consider that h0 is r3, just to make things simpler. Now the question is, we can understand what the definition of the input signal, but how do we build a hierarchical representation that look like what CNNs are doing? So we can do that by applying a sequence of operators on a signal xk minus 1. So we are going to go from xk minus 1, that lives in L2 of omega hk minus 1, and we are going to go to L2 of omega hk. And so what are these operations? I was telling you in the beginning that to build this CKN, the RKHS of the CKNs, what we do is that we replace the ReLU of A times X by a kernel mapping. So more precisely, if we want to be a bit more formal, what we do is that we apply a first operator on this map XK minus 1 that at every location will extract a patch. So a patch is simply a small part of the feature map xk minus 1, which is centered at point u, okay, such that pk of xk minus 1, if you query the value of u at u, it's a patch. Then each patch, instead of doing a linear operation followed by a pointwise nonlinearity, we are applying this nonlinear mapping operator, mk, which simply maps your patch to a new Hilbert space hk. And given what we have done in the previous classes, you know how to do that. We are going to define a specific kernel, and this will be the kernel mapping. And then we have this pooling operator that will simply smooth these maps. I will come back to that if you don't see the link between pooling and smoothing. It will come when I comment on the questions of stability. So here is an illustration. You have an input map xk minus 1. You extract. You do this patch extraction operator. So each patch is extracted. And this patch is sent to a new RKHS HK, which goes to this intermediate map here. So this point here corresponds to the mapping of the patch centered at the same location in the previous map. And then after smoothing your map, you get the new map XK. Okay. And of course, you can do that many times. So how do we do all of this? The kernel mapping for patches, we use a homogeneous dot product kernel that you should now be familiar with that because we have seen that already. I have already commented on the need for homogeneity, but you could also perfectly use a dot product kernel, which is not homogeneous, except that the stability results that we are going to prove, they actually require this homogeneity. Then you apply this operator many times, and you can have your multi-layer representation. So now what is the intuition about this? We built a sequence of maps, and every point in the map lives in some RKHS. So it's a it can be seen as an infinite dimensional representation of what? Of a specific receptive field. And when you go up in the hierarchy, you can show that the size of the receptive field is increasing. And we are also going to be able to prove that the amount of invariance of this representation is also increasing. So that's in fact what convolutional neural networks is doing implicitly in some sense. Okay, and of course, this is about the representation. So we have this sequence of maps, and the last layer, the prediction layer, is simply a linear model on these maps, meaning that phi of x is simply an inner product, because the maps, they also live in the Hilbert space, between parameters w and phi n of x, which is this multilayer representation here. It corresponds to using the linear kernel between the maps, okay, which can be defined as simply, since these maps, they live in L2, we can simply use the inner product of L2 to define a kernel. In practice, I was telling you as well, well, that was for the theory part. So in practice, computing the exact kernel between two images is in fact possible, but it's just very costly. So you don't want to do that in practice. And what we have seen is that when we have scalability issues, we can use Nystrom's approximation, such that the CKN mechanism in practice corresponds to do exactly the same construction I described for discontinuous signals, except that the kernel mapping is going to be approximated by a projection onto a linear subspace. We are going to use Nystrom's approximation. This allows us to build a sequence of maps in the exact same manner where we extract patches. We do Nystrom's embedding of these patches. It gives us a vector, psi 1 of z, where the dimension of psi 1 is the number of anchor points. So everything here is in finite dimension, which is nice because if you are a computer scientist like me, you don't like to implement things that live in infinite dimension. So you like to manipulate objects that have finite dimension. So this is what Nystrom's embedding is about. It's about producing finite dimensional embeddings. Then we can do also this linear pooling operation that corresponds to the smoothing operation that I was describing before, and you get the CKN in practice. Again, what is the difference with the CNN? Well, given a patch X, a CNN computes sigma of Z transpose X. Here, just to make things more similar, I'm using the same notation. The Z's, they correspond to the filters of the CNN, and the CKN with dot product kernel with this homogeneization, it corresponds to an operation which is slightly more complicated. It's kappa of Z transpose X, so very close to that. We do this normalization here and this homogeneization to make things actually homogeneous. It could work if you don't do it, but actually if you have many layers, it's safer to have it. And the main difference is this inverse square root matrix, which gives this interpretation in terms of Nystrom's embedding. So the consequence is that we have a geometric interpretation in terms of subspace learning at every layer, because we are going to stack several layers of this. And at every layer, you are learning a subspace of some RKHS where you project the data. It gives you also a supervised learning mechanism, which is the basic Nystrom approach, based on kernel approximation techniques. You can do supervised learning. I could have added a slide about how to do backpropagation through the inverse square root of a matrix. Actually, you can do that. I can give you some notes about this. The kernel interpretation provides regularization mechanisms, even so I must admit that they are very easy to use in the unsupervised setting, because this is a classical kernel approach. We know very well how it works. When you start optimizing everything end to end, things are a bit more complicated. So I should say that the regularization mechanism in the supervised setting is still an open problem. Even so, I have good hopes that we are going to be able to solve this problem. What is nice is that the kernel point of view also gives us lots of perspectives for in other contexts. You have seen, for example, the classes on kernel PCA, CCA, k-means. You can do statistical testing with these approaches. This is natural to do if you adopt the kernel point of view. So that's why it was also one of the motivations for this. Few experiments I'm going to comment. There is one which is interesting here. So something not interesting is that when I published this, 2015, 2016, I managed to be state of the art on one task. Well, that was not a big issue because, you know, the field is evolving very fast. So if you are state of the art in 2016, you are not state of the art in 2017. That's not a big problem. What I think is interesting is that, and why I say it's interesting, it's because it gives some intuition about the what this representation is doing. In 2016, I could achieve about 92% on this data set Cypher 10 with supervision by doing a very basic data augmentation. So I was using 14 layers, 256 anchor points per layers. I was not using anything like batch norm. I was simply using stochastic gradient descent plus momentum. It was considered to be a good number. It's actually the same which is achieved by a VGG network, for example. Today, of course, we can do better, but remember that was already something which is, this is already 5 years old. But what is interesting is that with no supervision, with simply a two-layer model and no data augmentation, I could achieve 86%, which I think is still a very good number in the context of unsupervised learning. And what was also very interesting is that to achieve this 92% here with supervision, you see that there are many layers. Each layer is using the same number of anchor points. And if I increase the number of anchor points, it's not clear that I will increase this number. Here, without supervision, it was really, if you add more anchor points, you get a better kernel approximation. And in fact, the performance was increasing. So this model here was simply the largest I could process on my machine, meaning the first layer has 1,000 of anchor points. The second layer had 16,000 anchor points, which is really a lot for Nystrom's method. But if I go up, the performance continues to increase. So that's why this is interesting. It means that we have a representation and we have exactly what is expected from Nystrom's approximation with the kernel method, which is you can provide, if you have more parameters, you have a better kernel approximation. And the kernel method has also the right mechanism to regularize such that there was no overfitting with this approach if you regularize correctly. That's what I say here. With no supervision, the performance monotonically increases with the dimension. You get basically better kernel approximation. Now, something I have not published, actually it was done by others recently. Computing the exact kernel does not make sense in practice for computational reasons, but it is feasible with lots of CPUs. For example, my former student Alberto Bietti achieved about 90% with three layers, but it was really using 300 cores during 1 week on one CPU, which does not make lots of sense if you want to process Cypher 10, for example. But it still shows that there is still a gap between the exact kernel doing here and what we can achieve using Nystrom. So there is still something to understand here. And there is also something to understand is, can we actually do as good as supervised learning just by computing a specific exact kernel with data augmentation and the right regularization? This is not clear to me yet. Okay, so I will still say, there are a few references about older works that still had also links between deep learning and kernels. In particular, there is a literature about deep Gaussian processes, which is related, it's not exactly the same point of view, but it's related to this work on deep kernels. Very early, that was this work about multilayer PCA. There was also work about using correlations between patches to define a kernel. For images, it's very related to a one-layer CKN. It can be seen in the PhD thesis of Bernard Scholkopf, I think, in 1997. And there is a relation also between this one-layer CKN and what are called radial basis function networks, which are also old networks.